Yes team, welcome back to the channel. So episode 5, we're down here at Rise Gym owned by Joe Murphy. He's going to go and take me through a pool session. I'm going to get a good insight as to Joe's journey in the bodybuilding world and also what's needed to actually own a gym. Joe, if you give yourself a wee intro to the channel.
Hi guys, I am Joe Murphy. I'm an online coach and personal trainer and newly the owner of Rise Gym Glasgow, which is based here in East Kilbride.
So you said it was 2020 was when you'd quit the other gym. I never knew how long you were planning this. How long's it actually been from start to finish?
So probably realistically, the first conversations were muted in 2015. 2015.
Oh.
And they were quite flippant, to be fair. But it's been in the back burner all the time. 2020 was the first time we actually viewed gyms with the potential of actually taking one on. Then it's been 2 years of viewing different units, different facilities, and they've all kind of been around about 2,000 square foot. We looked at actually another one in here. It was just over 3,500 square foot, and we thought that would have been the one. It was the top floor, it wouldn't have worked. So it actually worked in our favour, to be fair, because this part of the building's an extension, and then that's the main bit of the building, so we'll technically call it third time lucky.
7 years, like that's, because like see for me, it's kind of, I suppose like when you've got a plan like this, it's kind of like an iceberg, innit? Like I'm only seeing, and obviously I spoke to you not long ago about it, but I'm only seeing the tip of this. But I had 7 years of planning.
Even that, it was like, when people first came into the gym, they're like, where was all this equipment? Uh-huh. Where did you store the jungle gym?
So you had all this like long on before you store it?
So this has been probably, I would say between 14 and 16 months of storing stuff, stocking stuff, sourcing stuff, and putting it either in my garage, in my living room, my uncle's garage. So he's an old mechanic, so he's got like a workshop. I had a guy storing stuff down in Dumfries for me, that's where the Cybex stuff came from. And then the other stuff that was ordered like from Primal, just waiting for that to be delivered.
I think a lot of that will be though because you obviously take pride in this.
Aye.
There'll be a lot of people that will start a gym up and want to get done as quick as they can. Aye. Whereas you actually care about it.
I think as well, like the preconceived idea for most people, you see a lot of people now coming out on social media saying this, that if you're going for the aesthetic look, they'll just blanket buy all the same brand.
Mm.
Now, that makes things really, really easy, but there might be particular bits of kit you don't like.
Mm.
So you're just kind of buying that for the sake of aesthetic.
The sake of buying it within that, yeah.
Whereas
yeah.
I would rather go and cherry pick certain bits of kit. Now, there's bits of kit in here that even my OCD can't really cope with it. Like that hammer strength leg press, for instance, right? That brand new, you'd struggle to source that now because they don't manufacture it anymore. It's $4,500 brand new, and I got it off a guy from Facebook Marketplace in a barn for £450.
Yeah.
So it's like you find certain diamonds literally in the rough.
It's like that new to that one there, it's no difference.
I mean. The limitless leg press, it was built for the Pittsburgh Steelers.
That's something that I can't
I
didn't want to try that last time.
Heaviest load,
it's horrible, man.
I had my pal in on Saturday, Kev, very, very strong. He's coached by Cuba. He was down in Ultraflex and he did the Cybex hack, 5 plates a side for 11 reps. He came in here on Saturday, done 3 plates a side for 9
Couldn't
reps.
It.
So it puts it in perspective, do you know what I mean?
Obviously anyone can open a gym, but do you think anyone should open a gym? Obviously because you've had experience with like with bodybuilding.
Aye.
You've had clients for so long, do you think you need to have that background or?
No, I think one of the great things that kind of worked in our favour in industry was going through the period of lockdown, because a lot of people realised that they don't just utilise exercise purely for a compositional or an aesthetic standpoint, they need it for their mental health and wellbeing as well. So in that regard, people then started to think, do you know what, I want to go in a network, have a community, have a feel where I can actually enjoy it. So it's all fine and well going to a commercial gym, a pure gym, the gym group, whatever it may be, going to an independent gym, but if there's something that doesn't fit or doesn't sit right, people will dwindle away.
Yeah.
You know, ultimately our aim is to create a community ethos, a network of like-minded people that actually feel as if they want to be in a gym environment, push each other on.
For me, like, I've trained in loads and loads of different gyms and loads of like personal gyms, private gyms, but I've never really seen an ethos the same way as yours, to trust your members like that.
Well, for us, I think I was quite lucky in the regard that I've got a good network, a good team from my online coaching. And what we wanted to do was basically take that digital format and make it a physical thing as well.
Yeah.
Because too often what will happen is people all train in separate places. I met some of my clients for the first time actually the Monday prior to opening the gym. They turned up with like cards and cookies and donuts and all these things, which was amazing because you build a relationship over 18 months, 2 years, seeing these people
a long time
in their underwear, but you've not actually never met them face to face. Thought process of that is unbelievable.
Yeah.
But to see them in the flesh was just, it's priceless, absolutely priceless. And then to see like last night was busy, the atmosphere was buzzing, everybody's laughing, they're all chipping in, you know, it's worth its weight in gold.
Yeah,
honestly,
this is exactly why you've done this.
Of course.
Let's give it a shot.
Oh mate, what have you got?
Yes.
slow.
How's your training been since having that? I know obviously you had a bit of like a time it, but if there's any potential wannabe gym owners out there that think that this is a playground, like,
nah,
what's the reality?
No, certainly not in the infancy. Listen, it's like anything you do, and I would always preach that to my clients. The way I liken it from an analogy standpoint is, imagine you're like a sound engineer. You've got the treble, you've got the bass, you've got the volume, you've got all these equalizers that you've got to play with. Different periods in life, different things will be turned up and turned down based on where you're going, right? So as much as I would love to say, mate, training's been bang on the button, it's not. There was maybe about a 10-day period I didn't train at all.
Jeez.
And I'll be honest, I was ratty, I was irritable, stressed out my box. You see the knock-on effect? Not like people think that we do this because we're very vain, because we're obsessed about strength or building muscle. It's not up there.
Mm.
So yes, I'll get into a position inevitable at some stage where I can come in like the now and train and really enjoy it, get into it. Business is a priority then now.
Yeah. Do you find it hard to detach to that?
Aye.
Because I think for me, so I don't have any plans on a gym or anything like that, but for me, I think if I then built all this, I would just want to, it's more on training and stuff. Whereas you need to detach yourself from that and you need to think of it, how am I going to make this a reputable business?
Well, it's twofold, because even though you bring a client base in, you're mindful of other people coming in who are not part of your team.
Aye.
So you're trying to bring them in.
Which is quite difficult, I think, for you in a community vibe like this, isn't it?
You want to make everybody feel welcome, everybody gets it, right? One thing I've struggled with more than anything else is how OCD I am. Things, everything's got to be in the right place. So it's the plates have got to be there, those plates have got to, like,
take
no come
if
in.
You're going to be training or else you're
please
bad,
do,
he'll buy you.
That's the hardest thing, and I found myself, and I think my clients will admit this themselves, I've been in coaching them and my gaze will just move across the gym floor, like, you're not putting that in the right place. They're getting chalk on handles. But to be fair, like, once we've ironed those wee things out, it's been great. And to be fair, like, everybody that we've got that's signed up for a membership has been top notch.
Yeah.
As you know, obviously I touched on earlier on about the whole trust,
yeah,
honesty, respect thing. Sounds like a slogan for The Rock there, doesn't it? But the reality,
they're not far off on
there,
to be fair.
It's been top notch. And you can see that, you know, when people come in and there's a collective, and I think any coach out there would say that they want their team to have an ethos and a vision.
Yeah, massively.
And, you know, a real community feel. And we have that. We just need to make sure that we're somewhat selective in the client group that we bring in.
Mm-hmm.
We're open to all, but you have to have the right attitude and mm-hmm. the right mentality that you will fit the client group that are already
it's
here.
At the end of the day, we spoke a little bit earlier on, it's very similar. Like, with me and my online business, I don't just take on everyone and anyone, and it's the same in this gym.
Aye.
It's not just a case of, oh, like, you're paying for a month's membership and you come.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
And I think from a coaching standpoint, if you're starting as an online coach, you're at the mercy of taking anybody on because you need to pay the bills.
Mm-hmm.
Until you build up a reputation and a brand where you can turn around and say, I'd rather vet my clients mm-hmm. first and work with the right people.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're both lucky enough that we're in that position now where we have a degree of credibility that we can be selected to the people that we work with.
And it's such like a, what's the word, like, yes, yeah, very humbling, the fact that you can actually say, do you know what, you're not the right fit for me.
Aye,
so it's interesting you have that take with us, Jim.
Of course, 100%.
Interesting, because we spoke earlier on about having characteristics and experiences. Do you think you've taken things even from you being like a high school teacher or a primary teacher
uh-huh.
into this now?
100%.
So then it's interesting, because I think you'll probably think a lot of people say, oh, like, I've been in the fitness industry for so long and that's what allows them to open up a gym.
So I'll give you a prime example of that, right? If I was looking for a member of staff, right, to employ someone, they could come in and say, I've been a teacher for 20 years, and I look at their CV, they've been 20 years at primary one.
Mm-hmm.
So they've repeated that same year,
where's
20
the,
times
where's
over.
The progression?
There's no progression. Yeah. There's no diversifying their experience, nothing, right? I would rather somebody who was more holistic,
individual.
Aye, 100%.
Yeah.
Because they come with it with life experience. So for me, it was almost like, if I was so short-sighted and I only had this bodybuilder mentality, I wouldn't get it when you would come to me and go, Joe, I've got this event on. No, that's your plan, mate, mm-hmm. stick to that.
Mm-hmm.
It's no reality.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and in actual fact, we've also got to be humbled. These people are choosing to work to pay for us.
Mm-hmm.
So if we don't kind of bend a wee bit, they'll walk away.
Mate, I literally spoke of that in the car on the way up here, mm-hmm. about having that adaptable approach with a client, and it's not just a case of my way or the highway.
Aye.
You need to be adaptable, man.
Particularly
in this environment as well. Like, if a member came up to you and said, Joe, I don't like this there,
aye.
You just say, well, fuck off, it's my gym. I'll take that into consideration.
Totally.
And that's what allows for sustainability.
Aye. The wall that we have in the lounge, again, is another thing I took from school. So rather than it just being a generic feedback wall,
mm-hmm.
where people could just write up, great gym, Joe, right? Mm-hmm. There's nothing there to action for me.
Ask for the specifics.
Right? So it's like, I put up, you said, we did. So somebody could then turn and say, Joe, that bolt needs fastened. Thanks for letting me know, Mark. I tightened that last night.
Yeah.
Joe, we could do an extra couple of plates. Okay, I've ordered them. they'll be in next week.
Yeah.
So people feel listened to. And very often, I think now in this day and age, social media, instant gratification, everything else, nobody listens. Because everybody's so obsessed in their own head, they want to know exactly what they're doing. And they'll be polite, because what they'll do is they'll nod and agree.
Like me.
Let me do my set. But it's just like, whew, it's gone.
Yeah.
And then see when you actually then ask them questions, how did you get on with that? They go, fuck, he listens.
Yeah.
It makes a big difference.
I think what you're trying to do here is have that community vibe, that member vibe. You need to have that. Because if you're, it's quite easy for you to sit and say, these are my values, these are what I do. But if you have no action behind that, then what does that really mean? Nothing.
It's the same like me going in, clients coming in, and I'm hoovering and mopping and everything else. Now, I know what some people are thinking. Mm-hmm. Some people might think and go, oh, this guy's opened his gym and everything else, blah, 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 blah. Well, it's a lot of investment. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of time saving, right? But I'm not employing somebody to do that.
You're doing it if you don't.
I'm rolling the sleeves up and I'm doing it myself. Mm-hmm. You know, because people's almost like, well, who else is going to do it? But if I show the client, listen, it's me that's going about and wiping all the machines. Yep. The least that I expect you to do is clean your machine and put your thing back after it.
Lead from the front. Do you do that in your actual business as well?
Aye.
That's one thing I've been big on. Like, since I started with Ben, really, that's what he'd said to me from the very start. Spoke about my Instagram story. Mm-hmm. Who the fuck am I to go on and say, get your 10,000 steps?
If you're not doing it yourself,
so it applies to this. Do you think it's very, very similar, your own online business, to running this? Has it been an easier transition?
Aye. And what you've said there as well is be raw and be honest.
Yeah.
So if you've got genuine struggles and things that don't go to plan, share that with the clients, because it's relatable.
Yeah.
Right? People will respect you more for that.
Yeah.
So if I find myself in a position where battled mental health issues, or you're looking a wee bit fluffy, you've missed training for 10 days, whatever, I'll tell my clients that. Listen, my diet's been appalling. By the way, I couldn't help myself last night. I drove left here and I went for KFC. Mm-hmm. I'll tell them that, because they also hold me accountable. Mm-hmm. Good. Come on.
Yeah. Get shot.
Good measure. Come on.
You're an early riser, aren't you?
Aye.
So any potential gym owners that like a long lie-in, would you recommend? No? Because I know you're up at fucking 5:30 most days. Aye. What's the hours like?
So I'm in here for 5:30. The only days I'm not here is check-in days, which is then my long lie. Because I start like work at 7:30.
Aye. Start work at 7:30.
To be fair, like, that's something I've always done. Not on the back of like 5 a.m. club and, you know, work hard and sleep when you're dead, that mentality, nothing like that. I've just found that I've always been more conducive first thing in the morning, less distractions, and just crack on. Even when I was in school, latterly as a deputy, like, I was in my office at 5:30 in the morning.
Really?
Because the way I used to partition my work, so it meant like the stuff that was really pressing, get done early doors.
Yeah.
And the rest of the day, like, you win the first battle, you're going to win the war, do you know that way? So if I get up, get it done, everything else seems easier. It does mean I'm in my bed like 9 o'clock, 9:30.
Yeah. Against the new sacrifices norm. You make.
100%.
As well,
100%. And I don't miss being up late or anything like that.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
Pull through.
Up it.
Yeah. Yeah.
All you.
Come on in. Come on.
Oh, nice.
Keep it, Matt. Keep it.
So we spoke a wee bit about the process of actually getting to own your own gym. Probably spoke about a lot of the trials, tribulations, but now you're actually here. Class is a fucking brilliant setup. How gratifying is it? How proud is the process to actually get to it?
Listen, it's lots of sleepless nights, lots of stress. But to actually see it, I won't deny, like, I'm immensely proud of it, but you don't actually get to feel that until you see other people. It's a bit like cooking a meal for the missus, and you see that satisfaction in her face, the enjoyment in her face, seeing clients coming through the door and actually enjoying it. Guys like yourself coming in and going, really like this, a lot of thought going into it as well.
It's madness. Like, I didn't even know since 2015 you were planning this, but it shows. Do you know what I mean? It's like you've not just like jumped at the first opportunity you've had. It definitely shows.
It could have happened, Mark, without question, you know, that we could have taken different units that now on hindsight, I look back and go, do you know what? I'm glad that was a blessing.
Yeah.
Because at the minute, this seems like the best. It's ideal. It's got a wee courtyard out the front, secure entry, private parking. It's within a secure confined. You're not out, you know, on a main road somewhere where people might feel a wee bit more apprehensive. Mm-hmm. With this, you know, people know that they're secure, CCTV, security gatehouse, they've got all these added benefits that other gyms may not have.
Yeah.
I am very satisfied with how it is at the
process
moment.
Worth it?
Yes. As I said, a lot of sleepless nights, a lot of stress, big financial commitment as well, of course. A lot of saving, a lot of arguments, almost a divorce, might add.
Joined to the missus, that takes a brave man.
Aye, it does. But you get there and, you know, you'll be exactly the same. You get back what you put in.
Yeah, of course.
And for anybody from the outset that think that this just happens, a lot of people believe in the secret and everything else. The reality is you've got to put the work in as well.
Yeah, to reap the reward from it, yeah.
It's paid off, bro.
Thank you. Okay, Joe, so we've finished off our session.
Good one at that.
Yeah, it was a very good session. Just going to tick over some things if there's any potential gym owners out there, just from your experience of going through things. So, straight off the bat, what would you, now you've been through the process, what would be some of the things you would tell yourself in hindsight?
The demand is huge. The demand is huge in regards to the time it takes from picking equipment. Let's take it from the off, you know, going and finding the right place to actually open the gym.
Yeah.
Do your due diligence, you know, if it's a case of you're going to buy somewhere or rent somewhere and go through council permission and all this. Like, honestly, all the loopholes that you've got to go through is incredible. To sourcing your equipment, again, you'll have these preconceived ideas that it will cost a certain amount. You will far surpass that. Be prepared for delays. So, for instance, we've been open since the 1st of September. So what's this, the 12th, 13th of September now? Yeah. We're still missing one set of dumbbells. We're still missing two separate bits of apparatus. Not on our accord.
Suppliers
letting us down. And it's other unforeseen circumstances. Changing lights, looking for sparks, plumbers, carpet fitters, you name it. It's like all these tradesmen, you depend on them, their time, their schedule as well. So it's very, very stressful.
I think it's so important you love the process.
Aye.
If you're doing this for money, like, definitely
no,
get to it.
No.
What's three things that you regret now, again, looking back in hindsight? What's top three things you would say, fuck, I shouldn't have done that?
Agreeing that Megan was right. Megan was right in the regard that is, you'll love this. Megan told me quite a few times, right, rein it in now with buying equipment, and I couldn't help myself. I would see something on offer or something would prop up on Marketplace.
Kid in a candy store.
And I'd be like, get that, it's too good to be true. And then I found myself in the aftermath now selling it on because, like, I physically don't have the space for it. So yeah, the first thing would probably be listening more to the missus. Probably trying to do too much too soon.
Would be
another one. On top of that, Megan's marketing background had basically told us that don't expect what you think to occur will happen. So for instance, our wait list far surpassed the numbers that we could ever imagine. Like, it was unbelievable, the response on the wait list. And Megan actually said to me at the time, listen, from that wait list numbers, expect 20%.
Yeah, to actually be converted.
Right? And I was like, nah, no way. And we literally, like, the equipment we went through, right, who do we want as the founding members from that wait list? And we only sent out invites to those people who we knew. So it was almost like you were cherry picking the people that you could depend on, that they were the founding members that would be the backbone of the gym. But then it's a case of knowing, right, okay, what's the next position you get to in members, because you've never owned a gym.
Yeah.
So you don't know how many's too many.
Now that you've done the process, what's three things you think, I got that spot on? I can think of one. Aesthetics.
Okay. We were very clear in what we wanted. You know, we wanted it to be modern. We knew that we couldn't match, you know, a David Lloyd, a high-end environment. We knew equally so that we were going to be a step up from a commercial gym, but it's subtle wee touches that make a difference, you know, like the wall out the cardio room, you know, the Venetian plastering, the right equipment, the PlayStation in here, giving people trust, feedback, all these things. It's maybe kind of lost in gyms now because they're a wee bit soulless. So in here you've got an environment, you've got a feel. We obviously touched on lighting, we touched on smell, the sensory elements as well, and I think that they've made a big effort. They've made a big difference to the gym environment for our members so far.
I think a lot of people would open up a gym and just think, what equipment am I going to get? Is it for a workout? But you've obviously considered a lot of things into that, which is interesting to know. How do you continue to encourage clients coming through the doors? What plans do you have in place for that?
That's probably one of the biggest things. And I actually had this conversation with Megan recently, talking about segregating my business, because previously you just assumed that, well, if you've got an online business or a PT business, and now you've got the gym as well, you're trying to manage all these things with the same 24 hours a day. It doesn't become any easier, especially when you're in an environment where you do things online, you're always to hand.
What type of goals do you have for, obviously your business is thriving and it has been for so long, your results speak for themselves. What plans do you have for the gym? To scale or to stay where it's at?
It's quite funny because within like a week, people were saying, you know, what's the next step? The next step, realistically, we've signed a lease here for 5 years. If all goes to plan and all goes well, it would be to make it a bigger premises. And there's scope to do that even within this building, so you're not going further afield. In the infancy of the situation just now, we've got a good relationship with the landlord, and I don't think that that's off the cards.
Do you consider that when you got this? with that mindset.
Aye.
So you're even thinking what miles ahead even before that.
And it's like that, like we had the, we obviously had the dialogue outside where we looked at the external unit and it's like, could I take that on? Could that be used for classes? Could someone else come in?
That's crazy, the forward planning you have. It's not just this unit and that's it, it's where can I go?
And I think that's what you've got to do, because a lot of people are so short-sighted and they only think of the here and the now. Great to be present, but ultimately I think you've also got to think there's an impending recession. How many of these people are realistically value the gym? I think a lot of people, and you'll find this yourself as well, is an online coach, people buy into you.
Yeah,
they buy into you as an individual. Aye. When we're not here, I'm also mindful of, oh, does it kind of lose the feel? Mm-hmm. Because you're not on the floor, you're not seeing people and everything else. If I were to do that, if I was to branch out, and I've thought about that with GM as well, would the same level of quality be there?
Are you sacrificing service for 100%. Scalability in that? Yeah.
Is it worth it? No, because it goes against my moral and ethical code.
Mm-hmm. A lot of things to consider.
Aye,
a lot of things to consider. So hopefully any future gym owners out there have obviously taken a lot from Joe. Joe's been in this industry for so long, and it's shown in the gym he's got in terms of the values, in terms of the ethos that he's got. And without a doubt, Rise and his business will be scaling massively in the future. So thank you for the big session, mate.
Appreciate that, mate.
I'm sure it'll be sore the next few days.
I'm sure we will.
It's good.
I'm sure we will.